Let us take the case of India. Now this is the case of the our country. Now I just take two indicators. One is index of per capita income. It is not the actual per capita income of India. It is the index. I will explain what is index. And the other, this second, third column is the literacy rate. Now this index of per capita income in the various censuses, 1951, 61, 71 up to 2001. These are the census figures. Census years, and because census I have taken because the literacy rate is available for the census only. When we take the value 100, index 100 for 1951, it means that whatever the per capita income we had in 1951, that is taken to be 100. It may be say 326, so 326 is equivalent to 100. So 321 becomes 364. Instead of calling 364, that equivalent 100 value will be 119.8. Similarly, in 1971, with the same prices of 1951, price level is fixed. At 1951 prices, in 1971, the per capita income of India, this index of India is 134.9. In 81, it is 144.7. Similarly, in 1991, it is 198.8. It's almost doubled. 198.8 means between 1951 and 1991, in the last 40 years, the per capita income of India becomes double. And then 2001, it is 254.5. That means it becomes 2.5 times. Now we look at the third column. That is the census figure on literacy rate. Literacy rate is also increasing. When per capita income is increasing, the index of per capita is increasing, then literacy rate from 18.3% it increased to 28.3, then it increased to 34.5, then it increased to 43.6, 52.1, and finally 65.4. Again, you can see there is a link between these two. There is a concept in statistics called correlation coefficient. And I calculated this correlation coefficient, that is found to be 0.95. So this indicates that there is a very close relationship between per capita income, growth in India as well as literacy rate. Now again that question comes, whether the per capita income increases due to increase improvement in literacy rate or literacy rate improves because of increase in per capita income. It is very difficult to say which is true. Sometimes you can ask me the question whether egg come first or hen come first, which one? It is very difficult to say. The same is the puzzle here. But again I tell you that education comes first in the sense that without education and training you cannot have economic development. That how does educational development increase economy efficiency of the country? Economy efficiency means economy efficiency of the individual. And when economy efficiency improves, then definitely the development activity also increases. Income increases, there is social and economic development takes place. Now, so far as the economic efficiency is concerned, it is measured in terms of what is the rate of return of education. Now, when you make an investment, say in an industry, what do you expect? You expect some return. So that is a financial return. So if you get more return, then you make more investment. Say I give you two examples. Suppose for example, if you make an investment in a
small rice mill
and
suppose in the share market,
two options are there and you have 10 lakh rupees. So, in taking a decision whether you make an investment in rice mill or the share market, what is the criteria? We should give more return. If the rate of profit, rice mill is say, for example, say 10%. 10% if you get the profit. And in the share market, it is a 15%. So, of course, you have to decide, we have to see the risk factor, no doubt of it. So although the share market is giving high rate of return, you see the risk factor is also there. So the guiding factor is the rate of return. So similarly education also, when you make investment, the guiding factor is the rate of return. When the government is making investment, that is also guiding factor is the rate of return. When an individual is making investment, the guiding factor is the rate of return. Now why do you spend so much money for your children in education? Because you expect that there are two factors are there. One is social factor, you must give education to your children. Secondly, instead of putting him or her in just general BA course, why are you putting in engineering or in medical course? You expect more return from the investment.
So for cost is concerned, two types of cost is the private cost plus government cost. Private cost and public cost.
Now what are the private cost of education? Now I have already given that. That one is that the cost of tuition fees. Then secondly, it is the expenditure on books and stationery. Then maintenance expenses. Then private tutors. If you engage some private tutors, normally in the matriculation higher secondary level, the guardians normally put some private tutors. Those costs. And maybe some other cost also. So cost of dress, cost of transportation. These are the cost of education. Private cost of education. And what are the government cost of education? The public cost. Last point. The public cost of education include the cost of salary of the teachers and non-teaching staff. Then construction of building, provision of library books and journals, stationery and printing. So many other expenses are there for a school or a college. So these are the expenditures borne by the government. Now the cost is borne by two parties, government cost plus private cost. So the total cost is this, public and private cost. And then we compare the benefit derived from this particular investment. Now besides the government and private cost, there is another cost called opportunity cost. The opportunity cost is, it is the income which is foregone for making higher education. So for example, somebody of you, of course we are having the classes Saturday, Sunday. Suppose somebody is working in a particular school. I just give an example of this opportunity cost. Somebody is working as a school teacher and he has joined in the university as a student in MA classes. The school is, he was a graduate and he was earning some money. As a school teacher, let us assume that he was earning 10,000 rupees per month. And when he has enrolled in the university as a postgraduate student, he has to take leave. Not in distance mode, in a regular mode. So he take leave from the school, and if he does not get leave, he'll have to resign. It is assumed that he is taking leave without any pay. So leave without pay means he has to forego salary 10,000 per month in 2 years. It is about 2,40,000. So 2,40,000 he has to forego. So that is the cost of education. That is called opportunity cost. He has gone for a higher opportunity, higher education, so he has to incur some cost. That the cost of that he has foregone the income already earning as a school teacher. So that is the opportunity cost. So whatever the public cost, whatever the private cost, plus the opportunity cost who are working in certain job. So he is giving up, the income already earning in the particular job. And that foregoing the income is also called opportunity cost. All these three costs together is called the cost of education. Now when we talk about the benefit of education, benefit is the additional income earned by individual after improvement in skill and knowledge through higher education. So far as the benefit is concerned, benefit of education is measured in terms of lifetime earning of additional income due to enhancement of qualification, academic qualification training. So the example I have taken of this particular school teacher, I'll just explain it again later on. Now the rate of return, once you find out the cost and benefit, the cost consists of three parts, private cost, government cost and opportunity cost. And the benefit is the additional income earned by individual because of the enhancement of qualification and training. So what is the additional income is, and that is the benefit. And that additional income is not only for 1 year or 2 years, it's a lifetime earning. So the benefit will go, or benefit will accrue from the first year to the last year of his service. So suppose for example, a person is getting master's degree at the age of say 24 years, or 25 years. So from 25 to 60 years. So it's long of 35 years. After getting master's degree, suppose the particular individual got a job in this college, from his school job, 10,000 income, he will get about 25,000 income. they will jump in the salary. So this is because of the improvement in his qualification. He got master degree, he got NET, he got first class in the master degree, so obviously he got a job in the college. And because of the job, his income will increase from 25 years of age to 60 years of age till the retirement. So 35 years he will have an enhanced income, and that enhanced income is the benefit. These benefits are the base year, first year, second year, third year, like NF year. Suppose there are N years, 35 years. That is the benefit in the 35th year. So these are the benefits. B1, B2, B3, BN are the benefit, or B0 is also benefit. It is the base year, first year, second year, the NF year. Now, I'll explain the formula later on. Now, these are the benefits. And benefits in each year is not the same. Whatever benefit you will get in 2010, in 2011 benefit will maybe more. You will get an increment or some additional DNS allowance you will get. Third year benefit will be more. Similarly, 50 year, 60 year, whatever it is, in the last year of your retirement benefit will be many times. So benefit is not the same. That is why I am just writing B0, B1, B2, B3, BN. These are the benefits in the different years till the age of retirement. Now, what is the benefit today? Somebody get, say for example, master degree, you'll get a college job. And immediate salary is, the new scale will be about 35,000. So, just compare that, the benefit is different. So, what benefit I got in about 20 years back, or the benefit today's professor get many times. That is why I am saying that B0, B3, B1, B2, etc. are different and not the same. When you calculate the total cost of education, the cost of education, we compare the cost of education with the benefit. And to find out the rate of return, we usually use this formula. This formula is called the cost-benefit formula. We usually use in the economy analysis. One side we put the total cost of education. On the right-hand side we put the benefits. And benefits are discounted. Discounted by the rate of discount, R. So this is the R is the rate of return, and the formula is this: total cost is equal to benefit in the first year, B1, 1 plus R to the, actually this is, you can also put it like this, though the science teachers will know it. Actually the first one is B0 divided by 1 plus R to the power 0. B1, 1 plus R to the power 1, B2, 1 plus R to the power 2, 1 plus R to the power n. Now this is the usual formula for cost-benefit analysis, and the same formula is used to find out the rate of return. And R is the rate of return by solving this particular system. By solving this system, then we can get the value of R. So R is the Cauley rate of return. Now, once we get the rate of return, then it gives us an idea that whether rate of return of education is higher than the rate of return of, say for example, physical capital. Physical capital means investment in machineries, investment in fixed assets, investment in land, investment in building, investment in machinery. These are called physical investment, physical capital. And human capital is the investment in education. When you make the investment in education, it will lead to development of human capital. And on the other hand, if you make investment in physical assets, it will lead to improvement in the physical capital. Now the question is that whether the rate of return in human capital is greater than rate of return in physical capital. Sometimes it may be greater than physical capital, sometimes it may be less than physical capital, depending on the status of the economy. In a poor economy, in an underdeveloped economy, the human capital brings more return than the physical capital. And that is why you find that most of the developing countries, underdeveloped countries, they make more investment in education. They give free education. But if you go to the developed country, you will not get free education. Primary level is okay. The higher level education is so costly that it will be not less than 30-40 lakh rupees per year, cost of education, fee as well as the maintenance expenses. So why the underdeveloped countries or developed countries give more emphasis on education, particularly primary education? Because the rate of return is high. That the whole countries, of the world are divided into two groups. So this is the statistics provided by one Sosur Balas.
He wrote an article,
Economics of Education, some updated figure. Economics of Education. So this is a study made long back, about 20-25 years back, in 80s. And in these studies he has indicated that the countries where per capita income is less than $1,000, that time, in 1983. Now countries where per capita income is less than $1,000 in 1983, and the countries where per capita income is more than $1,000 in 1983. So the dividing the world into two groups. One group he calls it the poorer country, one group he calls it the
richer country.
At that time India's per capita income was about $300, not more than that. So 1,000 is quite good at that time. So this is the division of the countries, and on the basis of the statistics he found that the investment in physical capital in the poorer country brings about 15.1% return. That means if you make an investment of 100 rupees, you will get annual return of 15 rupees 10 paisa, 15.1%. And the same 100 rupees, if you make investment in human capital, in the education, return will be 19 rupees 90 paisa. So the return in human capital is much higher than the return in physical capital. The example, I take it in the other way round again. Suppose if you have 1 crore rupees to be invested in a rice mill or in some industry, you will get 15 lakhs, 10,000 rupees as a return, annual return. And the same 1 crore rupees if you make investment in education and training, your return will be 19 lakhs, 90 rupees. So purely from, say, commercial point of view, business point of view, your investment should be more in human capital, and that is why you find that these days education is a very good business. Education is a very good business in our country because the return is high. So what he predicted in 1983, that the return of human capital is more in poorer country than in the rich country. In the rich country, you just look at it, in the second group of country, the same investment brings more return in physical capital, 10.5% return in physical capital, and the same amount of money in human capital, in education, brings you about 8.3%. So in the developed countries, it is more advisable to make investment in physical capital, industries and other physical assets. And in the poorer countries or the underdeveloped countries, more advisable to make investment in the human capital. Because the return is high, return in human capital is high. Now I come to another table related to the economic efficiency. Now before that, let me ask you one question. These are the statistics provided by Sosur Balas. What is the justification for this statistic? What is the logic behind it? We get in the developed country, underdeveloped country or developing country, the physical capital gives less return and investment in education gives more return. And in the rich country, investment in human capital gives less return. What is the reason for this? The reason behind it, because the rate of return depends on two factors. The one is the cost of education and the other is the benefit of education. Now, so far as the cost of education is concerned, a major part of the cost is borne by the government. Whether you call it primary education, almost 100%, secondary education is also almost 100%, higher education a major part. So major part is borne by the state government. And whatever the cost of education borne by the private individual is very nominal, very less. Say, hypothetically, that for higher education, say let us say that 60% is borne by the state government and 40% is borne by the individual. And in the developed country, in the developed countries like USA, UK, Japan, that for higher education, 10% is borne by the state government and 90% is borne by the, almost 90% borne by the individual. So you bear more cost. The benefit is more or less same. Benefit is more or less same. A particular person getting master's degree in USA, after coming back to India, is getting the same salary. But the cost of education is very high. He is spending several lakhs of rupees. And a student doing master in Guwahati University just spent, say, 40, 50, 60,000 rupees, the whole course. So definitely, compare the cost, return is very high. Return is very high. That is why in a poorer country, this return is 19.9%. And in the advanced country, 8.3%, less than half. Because in an advanced country, you have to bear the higher cost of education. You now come to the other part of this, so physical capital is concerned. Physical capital in the underdeveloped country, it is 15.1%, in developed countries it is 10.5%. So the reason behind it is that in the developing country, a small amount of investment bring about large production. Because already our technology is very low level. Already technology is very low level, and if you make small investment in this whole process of production, then it will bring it more production and profit. But in the advanced country, technology is already high, and if you make a small investment, it will not bring any productivity. You have to make huge investment, then only you get more productivity. That is why the return of physical capital is also low in developed countries. Both are low. Both human capital is low as well as physical capital is low. But if you compare to developing country, that human capital in developing country brings more return. And in the developed country, physical capital brings more return. That is why in developed countries, government does not make investment in education. And in developing country, government makes more investment in education. And with private organization also make more investment in education. Education is a very good business in our country. That is why a lot of investment is coming up. We forget about Guwahati and other places. You see many parts of the country, even the rural areas, these English medium schools are coming up. So it's a very good business because the people have a ambition to have a better education to their children. I do not know whether it is better or worse. Mm-hmm. We are all educated in the government primary school. Now I take this example of this particular person about the rate of return. The person I was talking about, suppose he is a school teacher working in a high school. Let us assume that he worked in the school for 5 years after graduation, after BA, and at the age of say 25 years. Normally a student study, or let us say 28 years. A student normally study master degree at the age of 21, 22. Let us say that after working 5 years in the school, he joined at a later age, at the age of 28 years. The university, let us say Guwahati University, he suppose master degree in any subject, let us say education or history. And he was a school teacher. While doing the school job, he was getting 10,000 rupees per month. So when he has come to the university for 2 years, how much money he has to forego? He has to forego 2,40,000 rupees. Because he is not getting leave with salary, leave without pay. Leave without pay, he has to forego 2,400. Then let us assume that the monthly expenditure is 5,000 rupees. So 5,000 into 24, it comes about 1,20,000, the maintenance cost at the rate of rupees 5,000. So it is 1,20,000. Then university fee, let us say in 2 years 10,000. So these are the cost of education of the particular person. This is the maintenance cost. Minimum I am talking about 5,000 rupees per month. This is the 2 years fee altogether, and this is the opportunity cost. So this comes to about 3,75,000. This is the total cost of education of the particular school teacher. And hypothetically assume that he has joined the Guwahati University in 2010.
and by 2012 he will pass out.
Or let us hypothetically assume that he joined the university in 2008. He joined the university in 2008 and he will pass out 2010. And let us also hypothetically assume that after passing out, he got a job. Let us say he got the NET while doing the final year study. He got NET and he passed out, and in 2010, somehow it seems that he got a job in a good college. So he immediately, his income become 25,000 minimum, or 30,000. His income become
30,000 per month in 2010.
In 2008, his income was 10,000. So what is the benefit? Benefit, direct benefit is monthly his income increased by 20,000. And this he will get when he studies at the age of 28. In 2008, his age was 28. And in 2010, his age is 30. So at the age of 30, he became a college teacher. And he is now drawing 30,000 per month. And prior to that, he was a school teacher and he was drawing 10,000 per month. So direct benefit, in the monthly benefit is 20,000. And annual benefit that the figure I just gave you is B naught. The first value is the benefit in the first year. 20,000 per month in 12 months, his first B naught is 2,40,000. Then B1, at least it will be 2,40,000. It cannot be less than that. But you will get an increment, and these days increment is 3% of the total pay. So let us say it become hypothetically 2,50,000. B3 is 2,62,000. Like that, B4 is, let us say, 2,80,000. And BM means B30. Because he joined the college at the age of 30 and he retired at the age of 60. And then B30 means 60 years of age. So his salary will be not less than, I do not know at that time what his salary. Maybe some, his benefit may be 10 lakhs rupees per year. Maybe 10 lakhs, maybe not less than that. Now it is 2.5 lakhs or 2.4 lakhs. But after 30 years, it will not be less than 10 lakhs rupees per year. Now what is his sacrifice? Sacrifice is 2,40,000 rupees he has foregone for 2 years. That is his opportunity cost. Another sacrifice is that he has made expenditure of 1,20,000. Then another is, so total sacrifice is 3,70,000 is the total cost of education. And his benefits are 2,40,000, 2,50,000, 2,62,000, etc., etc. Maybe the last benefit may be 10 lakhs rupees or 12 lakhs rupees. So the total benefit goes on increasing. Then he has to make the comparison of this benefit along with this cost of education. Along with the cost of education. Now when you compare, use this formula. After comparing, then you'll find out the rate of return. Rate of return, maybe I do not know. After calculation, it will give you say maybe 20% or 25%. The value of R may be 0.25. In percentage form, it is 25%. Suppose if you say the benefits are equal, benefits are not normally equal. Then you can take B common, so science teachers you know it. You can take B common and then it will be 1 plus 1 by 1 plus R, 1 by 1 plus R square, 1 plus 1 by R to the power 3, then 1 by 1 to the power R to the power M. Then you take inversion, it will be 1 plus 1 plus R to the power minus 1, 1 plus R to the power minus 2, 1 plus R to the power minus N. So you can follow the summation of series and you get the result. And if benefits are not equal, then also you can calculate it and find out the value of R. So this is how this is calculated. And just look at it. The person make an initial investment of 3,70,000 rupees. And final benefit may be, I do not know, 60 lakhs rupees. By making investment of 3,70,000, the total benefit is 60 lakhs. But again that question comes. So whatever the benefit he gets in 2010 and whatever the benefit 10 lakhs rupees he gets in 2040, after 30 years, it is not comparable. because the value of money goes on decreasing. The value of money in today, 2010 and 2040 is not the same. Getting 2,40,000 today and getting 10 lakhs after 30 years may be either almost same or maybe less also, nobody knows it, depending on the cost of living. That is why this will have to be rediscounted, benefit will have to be rediscounted if you want to have, find out a real rate of return. This is the money rate of return, 20% or 25% money rate of return. But the real rate of return will be less. Because if getting 10 lakhs rupees after 30 years and getting 2 lakhs rupees today, I think 2 lakhs rupees today is more than 10 lakhs rupees after 30 years. So you have to rediscount it. That is a some formula is there, that rate of discounting in the say commerce and business studies. What you can do that, you can find out the rediscounted. 10 lakhs will, the value of 10 lakhs at today's price will not be 10 lakhs, it will be some 2,70,000. So that value you will have to take. Then you will get the real rate of return. This is the money rate of return. And normally money rate of return is taken, whatever you make investment today, you find out what will be the benefit in the long run. So this is how we find out the rate of return.